Excellency is present, my old friend from Bangladesh and many others. I am speaking because I love to speak on this subject. It's one of those Indian mysteries about when I speak of Indian culture, incidentally, I'm referring to the Indian subcontinent. I'm not referring to the three parts of it or the four parts of it. I'm referring to something that was organic, natural, and happy. The political division of India around 7 decades ago is just too close to us to let it spoil the conversation. Actually, I have not even seen this. I mean, I've prepared something in my office set, so I'll look here and speak once in a while. The issue is, people ask me once in a while, that is it true that could you put India as one of the longest living civilizations? To make a wild claim like that, to make a strong claim like that, one would have to have some empirical proof. If you look back at the three, four oldest civilizations in the world, the Egyptian, which was by far the most material civilization, oldest. Ruptures happened along the way. And though the Egyptian Muslims are proud to belong to a stock that preceded Islam, that preceded the Arab conquest, they still are under an overarching pan-Arab feeling. And there is doubt as to whether it's the same group that's continued from the time of the Pharaoh's day. And if so, what of the Pharaonic tradition is being continued today? These are the open questions. Babylon was another civilization, one of the hydraulic civilizations like Egypt that depended on river systems, and prosperity that came from river systems. But Babylon went through a lot. And it's not the same Babylon. Iraq is not the direct inheritor of whatever was learned in Babylon. I'll have cut this short and go there with very strong statements. In a way, let's try to see whether India can claim a direct lineage for 5,000 years. Two caveats. It's not that India has maintained a continuum which is totally unbroken. No, that's not good. There have been breaks. And number two, there have been periods of amnesia, periods when India forgot its linearity and had to regain it at some interval. It's like a conquest that destroys memory for some time, but then builds up. In other words, what is the lesson that came out of this civilization of 5,000 years, or a series of civilizations that occupied the same place for 5,000 years, and has it affected, how does it affect modern India and the public? Next. When I take India, I talk of the land between the Afghan mountains, the Himalaya on the north, and the Burmese mountains, or the hills on the east and everything, which include Bangladesh, which include Pakistan, which include Nepal, to some extent Sri Lanka. They have commonalities, so this is not an assertion saying that we are all there. We were all there, as I said, 6 or 7 years ago. And every country on that map is an inheritor of the common legacy. Next. Between 3000 BCE before Christ, that was Bharati era, and 1500, these are approximate years, we had this Indus Valley civilization that sparked up with a lot of modern expressions. This period, though we are concentrating on the Valley of the Indus, half of which is now in Pakistan, half of it is in India, let's remember what it's like handling agriculture. Number one, build houses. City planning of a type that will take the rest of the world a long time to have. Geometric roads, drink planning, water supply, sewerage, sewers all through the town, meaning from the bathroom toilets in the house onwards. And we have it all there for people to come and see. 1,500 years, this civilization flourished and was coterminous with the Middle Kingdom of Egypt, the Kingdom of Babylon, and at last towards the middle joint, it was there coterminous with China as well. Now, this doesn't mean that the rest of the white part of India had no civilization. This is my submission. This was what we call the uncharted territory. We had tribes, we had indigenous nations, we had their systems of governance, we had notions about their state of primitivity, from one might put it. But let's also remember that Indus Valley was also there in the Bronze Age. Indus Valley is not a product of the Iron Age, it's a product of the Bronze Age. And in the Bronze Age, if you can work out well-planned cities for miles together, crossroads, geometric angles at which streets meet, you have sewerage, you have city planning for life. That happens nowadays.
Spread into the Gangetic Valley, Ganga Valley as well.
This is the shape of Gwendolyn Harappa. You can see the geometrical shapes, wide streams, plains, worship. Next. Here in the United States, brick houses, drainage. And Harappa had 35,000 inhabitants at that point of time, one of its house. This is one of the large wells. It's still there for people to see. Next. Most developed among the countries are in the social organization. And without a social organization, no amount of rural prosperity can be built. It has to be a combination between the mental and the material, between the culture and the civilization. It introduced sanitation to the world, the first sanitation. We have the problems of sanitation right now. So we are reminded that there was a time when we didn't have these problems. Next. We then get the Indo Aryans. Now, there are controversies now. Where are the Europeans? Because the language is definitely Indo European. It's also the Indo European group. And when I hear Portuguese words, when I hear German words, when I hear French words, I can understand the basics. It's for us, it's Mundo, Roy, Papa. It's the same thing. It's a joke. We go down and the roots are the same. So words. Now this introduce, we have other than that, Oscar-like groups. Just in case people think it was all white, it wasn't. We had ostrich groups also populating in India. And between the clash between the two, that is the, we call them Meridian, it's a much better term for us, between the darker people and the lighter skinned people, we had what is called, we call it Temuruko, as we call it here, the mixed groups appeared. Aryan warriors, Aryan warriors dominated India for about 500 years unchallenged. They had superiority and they introduced the Iron Age to India. And iron provided, as you know, in the 6th century BC, a certain freedom all over the world. Because iron got into plowshares, iron got at the tip of the bow and arrow, iron got into swords. So whoever possesses iron was possessing nuclear weapons of that age. That was the highly carbonized iron. It's called steel-like iron. It would cut through anything that the bronze civilization had. So obviously, as iron bearers and horse riders, they got ready to run. What is their contribution? Their major contribution is the language. First and foremost, we are huge wealth of philosophy. A huge wealth of philosophy. And sometimes it puzzles me as to how a warrior had so much God and philosophy, the spirit, the soul, the dark one, the all of it. So obviously they had some who were concentrating only on the concept of philosophy. I don't fancy a philosopher with a sword in his hand. So obviously their society had provisions for both. From 1500 to 900, we have their flowering period. He sold the Vedas of the Vedic period. This is the period when the Vedas of knowledge are now written. 900 BC is usually taken as the year in which the alphabet enters, the written alphabet enters India. This is the Phoenicians that the first written alphabet. It doesn't matter to us who did it, but the written word comes in. Until then, Indian civilization was built on memory. On memory. And memory, gentlemen, is one of the sharpest things that we